All right, welcome to Using Student Workers in the Delivery of Data Services. I'm Bob Ray Bordelon from Princeton University. All week long, we've heard about various innovative approaches to providing data services. And you may be wondering how you can tackle any of this, given that many of you are the sole data librarian. In many cases, you're not even the sole data librarian, you're a fraction of a librarian because you have all these other jobs to do also. So what we're gonna do in this session is we're gonna do something a little different. So one, congratulations for making it this far in IASSIST. This is the last set of presentations. Of course, we still have the lightning talks to look forward to, as well as the closing session, but this is the last set of talks. So we're gonna try to transition you. So we're gonna start with a presentation. We're gonna have a brief summary of another presentation, and we're gonna invite you to watch videos later about various services. Some of you may have already watched them, but if not, that's okay. You can watch them later. And each of the videos talks about how they're using student workers to deliver data services in their respective institutions. As always, the slides and recordings will be made available. It may take about a month for all the different sessions throughout the conference to be available. And what we're really gonna wanna do in this one is to have a conversation with you about how you student workers, and maybe even talking about launching a cooperative service. As always, use the Q&A in Zoom for questions you have. Use the chat for any comments that you may have, but Q&A for actual questions. You can read our more detailed bios in Whova, but I'm just gonna very briefly give a couple of things about the first two people, and then I'll come back after they go. So Rob O'Reilly is going to be presenting live. He is a data librarian at Emory University, Atlanta, Georgia, United States. His primary duties include helping students and faculty with finding and accessing data. In addition, he provides support, both technical and emotional, for cleaning data, including teaching workshops on data cleaning and visualization. He does not dream of for loops, but has had nightmares about regular expressions. And then Ryan Womack is the data librarian at Rutgers in New Brunswick, New Jersey, United States. As data librarian, he serves as the primary expert on data sets and statistical methods, assisting his community in locating and using data, and with developing services promoting data and statistical literacy, including supervising the graduate specialist program that he will talk about today. And he has videos of different lengths, which he'll explain, that you can watch later. So we're going to start with Rob in the last full presentation of today. Go for it, Rob.
Okay. So can you folks all see this here?
We can.
Excellent. So thank you everyone, and thank you for coming out for our panel this afternoon in Eastern Standard Time. And I'm going to talk, like Bob Ray said, about the role of graduate students in providing data services in the Woodruff Library, the library at Emory where I work. And to say a little bit more about the sorts of services that we do, just to briefly reiterate, big part of it is finding and accessing data, and this can be on any range of topics, but also a lot of work of helping people with data cleaning, with getting data ready so that they can actually start to analyze them. And this can take the form of helping people work through coding issues, or even take the form of actually writing up code for people depending on the circumstances. And the constituencies that we have for this particular part of data services, focusing on kind of numeric and quantitative data, it's mainly undergraduates, then graduate students, and then some faculty and research staff as well. And we do get a truly eclectic mix of questions because we interact with folks pretty much from throughout the university, mainly in the social sciences, but a lot of public health, quite a fair bit of business too. And then also questions from other fields like the law school, the history department, that sort of thing. And some of these questions, and probably each and every one of us has had this experience, some of these questions are certainly decidedly idiosyncratic, with a request for data on internet usage prior to 1950 being a particular favorite of mine in terms of idiosyncratic questions. And some of the questions that we have and the consults we engage in, they're more kind of one-offs. They can be quite intensive still, but we meet with someone once, maybe twice, and then that's it. With other folks, especially with honor students and master's thesis students, we're meeting with them repeatedly pretty much throughout the duration or entirety of their particular projects, from the early stages and then closer to completion. And I will say that the work that we do, to a certain degree, we are helping fill a vacuum, because methods classes, I think I'm comfortable making this generalization, they don't always go into intensive detail about the nuts and bolts of actually cleaning up data and getting them into a usable form. So helping people with those sorts of tasks, which is a big part of what we do, it is helping them get answers to questions that the courses they take don't always cover. And that is part of where the emotional support or whatnot comes into play. We have had more than one instance of flow my tears, the thesis students said over the years. So saying to people, look, we know this is a challenge, but trust us, we're going to work through it. That is often a core part of data services, even if it isn't necessarily formally documented anywhere. And I should note that data services also has its own talisman, its own icon, its own guru, the red swing line stapler. When morale is wavering because the regular expression match and stata just isn't working, or the per function in R is just giving a completely unintelligible error message, the red stapler is where we get the morale and inspiration that we need to plow through and figure things out. But that is not ultimately what I am here to talk about. What I am here to talk about is the role of graduate students in all of this, both in finding data and in helping people actually get data into usable form, because they have been vital to both of those parts of the data services that we provide. So the labor needs that we have, basically given the sorts of questions that we get, we need folks who have really good data-related skills, folks who have experience thinking about things like, what's my unit of analysis? How am I operationalizing these concepts I'm interested in? And what sorts of data do I need to actually address my questions? Because these are the sorts of questions other folks are asking us for help with. And another need that I have is folks who are going to be available several hours a week for extended periods, so that if we get a particularly intensive question that's going to take a lot of time, I can delegate it to the student, and I know that person's going to have the time to take care of it within the week or something like that, or be able to meet with an honor student repeatedly during the course of that thesis project. So the actual labor supply that we have, where we get our grad student workers from, they are advanced graduate students in the dissertation completion phase of their time at the university. So by that point in time, they've already got plenty of experience working with data for their own work, for research assistant duties on behalf of a professor as part of another project they've gotten involved in, that sort of thing. And they are funded to do this work in data services via a fellowship from the graduate school, from the Laney Graduate School at Emory University. And the graduate school has a lot of dissertation completion fellowships, including a set of fellowships to work in different parts of the library. And since 2000, this has included a fellow to work in data services specifically. So basically each year I have a fellow working with me, and the time commitment for that fellowship is an average of 16 hours a week for 9 months from September through May. And you can see some other details here about the actual compensation for the fellowship as well. Now, in terms of what I'm looking for with fellows and what makes for a good fellow, the main thing I'm interested in, folks who have some combination of skills that are a complement to my own, folks who are good at things I'm not necessarily as good at. Given that we interact with people from throughout the university and different parts of the university have different software preferences and things like that, folks who are multilingual, that is especially important. And proficiency in R is something that has been also increasingly important for me over the past couple of years as we've gotten more and more questions about that particular application. So R proficiency is something that very much complements my familiarity with Stata. And also folks who have kind of in-depth knowledge about data sources that are relevant to the sorts of fields we get questions from. So folks very proficient or well-versed in data sources used by people in economics or public health, political science, sociology, those sorts of fields. And another thing that's very important is folks who already have a bit of experience working with undergraduates in a teaching or maybe a kind of a research mentor relationship as well, since undergraduates are the main group of people with whom we work. And people who just enjoy playing around with data, people who, when they see a data puzzle, they think, oh, this is really cool. How can I figure this out? People who come to the fellowship with that sort of attitude, they really bring a lot to the table, they really contribute a lot, and they get a lot out of it as well because of all the data-related puzzles that we have to work with. So the pros and cons of the fellowship, just to say a bit about this, the main advantage is we get these folks who are really, really experienced and really proficient at working with data and the sorts of data and data questions that we get asked for help with. And the time commitment the fellows have give me lots of options in terms of flexibility, scheduling, and being able to delegate things to fellows to take a look at. But the fellows do, not surprisingly, tend to be very specialized. They're often very well versed in data relevant for their particular work, but they're not necessarily, and quite understandably, not necessarily as well versed in data sources outside their primary fields of interest. So there is a bit of a gap here, and there is some orientation in the fellowship to help remedy or address this. So part of it is focusing on data sources, ones that we work with quite a bit, kind of data's greatest hits, if you will, things like data collections from the Census Bureau and using Social Explorer and Ipsos to get different types of census data. ICPSR, which is very familiar to a lot of folks, but maybe they're not as familiar with the variable level searching, for instance, or as familiar with the bibliographies associated with data sets, which can be very useful for undergrads. So we'll spend a little bit of time maybe talking about those specific features, things like ROPR for public opinion data, and things like Federal Reserve Economic Data Portal and the World Bank as good starting places for all sorts of macroeconomic and other macro data for the US and elsewhere. And then a big part of the orientation takes the form of a sequence of software exercises or training exercises I've put together and tweaked over the years. And this is something I started doing in the late 2000s, because even by then, we were already starting to get questions from people looking for help with what would wind up being very complicated data cleaning, data management tasks. Things, again, they're not always exposed to in methods classes. So I put together this sequence of exercises, which is kind of cumulative in that one exercise builds to some degree upon a previous exercise. And you can see the tasks that we cover here. I will say that of the various things the fellows work on, regular expressions are often what they find the most vexing or challenging to wrap their heads around. I do not necessarily uniformly endear myself to the fellows by introducing regular expressions to them. There was actually someone who was a former fellow of mine a couple of years back, sent me a note saying, "I am naming this day Adventures in Regular Expressions and I am dedicating it to you." And the tone of that message made it abundantly clear this was not meant as a tribute or a compliment or anything of that sort. But even as vexing as they are, regular expressions are really powerful. So it's good to introduce folks to them because we use them so much and take so much advantage of them. Initially, these were Stata-based exercises, but over the past few years, I've transitioned them, translated them into R exercises. And the exercises are actually drawn from past consults and questions, including in some cases, things that a previous fellow worked on. This is basically to help a new fellow get a sense of, you know, these are the sorts of things you're going to be doing when it comes to cleaning data and helping people get data into shape so that they understand the sorts of things they'll be asked to do and whatnot, and help them get a better sense of what awaits them during the fellowship. And for a given exercise, we'll start with basically a data set that's kind of the desired end result. And I'll say in this exercise, you know, you need to recreate this exactly. And then we'll talk about some particular commands or functions or packages to help them do all of that. And then when the exercise is done, we take a look at the fellow's code. We talk about different approaches, how I had approached the exercise, for instance, and that interchange and whatnot of different approaches. That's something that's actually also quite beneficial for me. And we also, part of the exercises is also to introduce folks just to the general sort of approach we take in helping people write up code. Basically writing up code with an eye towards more in the way of reproducibility and transparency. So whatever data cleaning a script file does, for instance, whatever data set is produced, as much as is possible, all of that work is done within the code itself, as opposed to some of it was done in Excel outside of the code or that sort of thing. And the syntax should run from start to finish. If there are any packages or functions or commands that need to be installed, that needs to be documented and explicitly noted in the syntax as well. This is a big issue with R naturally, but it's also an issue with Stata because there are lots of user written commands we use there as well. And then additional annotations and comments that clarify what the code is actually doing. This block of code does this, and it contributes this to the actual output that the code produces in its entirety. So then once the orientation is out of the way and we have the actual division of labor in terms of how the fellows and I handle and divvy up consults, if I'm gonna ask the fellow to work on something that's maybe outside the fellow's general area of interest or background, we'll have some initial conversations about particular data sources I think might be relevant. So we've already spoken about the World Bank, for instance, let's just say, but for this particular question, I'll say to the fellow, take a look at the Quality of Government Institute and OECD.stat, for instance, as well. So if the orientation covers data's greatest hits, here we're talking about the deep cuts, the B-sides, the unreleased demos from the club days, whatever metaphor you want to use here. And then there's also with the consultations, something we've done a lot in the past couple of years, even pre-pandemic, was shadowing each other. where both of us are involved handling a particular consultation, even if one or the other of us is taking the lead. Something that I've grown to appreciate about this is basically when the fellow and I are both meeting with someone and we're bouncing ideas off of each other and talking through different things and asking clarification questions, that often gives a more kind of fleshed out or rounded perspective to the question someone has. And especially for undergraduates, I think that can be very, very useful. And then also as the fellowship proceeds, I just start to get a better sense of what is this fellow's comparative advantage? What sorts of things can I just forward to the fellow and say, take care of this, and I know everything's going to be fine. So there are lots of benefits then from this program for the students themselves. You have these really smart, vibrant, engaged graduate students with all sorts of chops, and they're helping people and applying those skills to their particular data-related questions and tasks, and basically helping students, especially undergraduates, take their research where they want to take it so they can engage in their topics the way they want to, by testing hypotheses, evaluating arguments, and all of these things. The fellows themselves, because they're working with people outside their normal areas of interest, they encounter data they might not have otherwise seen. They figure out tricks and techniques for working with data they can use for their own purposes. And they get a lot of experience working with undergraduates in a research context, which can be especially beneficial for them in their future careers. And then there's what I get around from it, just being around these really smart folks who teach and show me a lot of things as well. So I should acknowledge all the various fellows who have worked for me over the years, going back to the early 2000s and into the early 2010s. And then in more recent years, each and every one of them has brought a lot to the table and done a lot of good work in helping folks get their data together. So even though the fellowship is only about 9 months and, you know, the light that burns twice as bright burns half long as all of that, they still really contribute a lot. And they've been absolutely invaluable for me over the past several years. So that is my presentation. Thank you all very much for taking the time to listen to me today. And I would be glad to address any questions that you might have in the chat or for the remainder of the panel that we're all going to be together. So thank you all very much for your time.
Thanks, Rob. So there's a number of questions in the Q&A. And so Rob is going to be answering those in the Q&A as Ryan gives us the shortest of his video versions.
Yes, so let me just get my screen share going. Does that look like slides to you? And so I'm just gonna run through this very quickly because, and I should put in the chat as well, there's a link here which you can access both the short slides, a longer version of the slides, and three different lengths of this presentation, because the first time I tried to record it, I ended up rambling on for almost an hour. Probably not too many of you will want to see that version, but this is just to give a framework as we move into the more discussion portion of things. So, a little bit of background. So we have a program that's called the Graduate Specialist Program. And similar to others here, for several years, I have been a data librarian with not so many others at Rutgers. I won't say just by myself, but and a demand for more workshops of different kinds, Python in particular. We have a single digital humanities librarian, and the two of us have been kind of a core of developing workshops and data-related programming, but there was always a demand for more. We had a phase where we were pursuing grants that were ultimately not successful, but I want to acknowledge that because it seeded a lot of ideas for this program, which we piloted in spring 2018, so that's the pilot in our title. We started with two graduate students, one for quantitative data and one for DH. I also want to acknowledge the support of our director at New Brunswick Libraries, Dee McNoney, throughout this process, because she's been funding this as something that fits in with our strategic plan goals, which you can look at here, and things like enhancing the research ecosystem, strengthening faculty and graduate student research. And most of the things on this slide, I think our program helps with that. We defined our program in this way because we don't have the ability to have full-time staff support like some other data services operations. We do have a large graduate student population at Rutgers. We chose the term graduate specialists because it doesn't collide with anything in the namespace of other position titles at Rutgers. And so we always stick to that graduate specialist. As Rob was saying, this is designed to be a skill building opportunity for the students themselves. And we design what they're offering around their interest and their expertise. They come in with lots of different things that they do or want to do. Even though we have a kind of core of like a Python sequence and a DH sequence, every semester is a little bit different. A key aspect of the program, this was new for us at Rutgers, was to hire non-library trained students and hire at a higher wage rate than our standard wage rate. So that was actually took some convincing locally, but it's been a key to pulling the right kinds of students. And during our pilot, we got started, we created some spaces for information for our LibGuides, a GitHub repository for content that was suitable in that format. And then I'm going to skim over these slides really briefly. We have expanded since then. We had good feedback after the pilot. We went to 4 specialists, then 5. We added qualitative and GIS specialists. From the beginning, we always had a demand for webinars. We were delivering these mostly in person. And finally, when COVID hit, we were forced to catch up and deliver what had been asked for all along. This is just to give you a flavor of our cohort from last year, our various graduate specialists, topics that were offered in spring 2020, ranging across a number of different tools and approaches. And this slide is our departments who attended the Python series. And I think for each of our workshops, we find that it cuts across a lot of areas of the university, which has been very, very interesting. Now, another piece in the title of this presentation is from pilot to JetStream. And another piece of our efforts was to have not only more support, but more collaborative workspace, more interactive teaching styles. And again, we had an opportunity to fund renovation of a room in our library. This is really the first space that we've had that was not banks of computers sort of in rows, and a flexible, configurable space that we want to encourage as a space for interactive discussion. However, this was finished in January 2020, so we only got to use it a few times before COVID closed us down. I'm looking forward to going back to that space. Our registrations for this COVID year were really way, way up in the fall because people seemed to be, they were thrown into the online environment and they were looking for anything they could grab a hold of. That's fallen back to a more normal level, but still a gradual increase for us in the spring, I think from Zoom fatigue and things like that. We implemented a LibCal calendaring system that managed our bookings and registrations and the visibility much better than ever before. That was a big innovation. And then finally, this I think is maybe the most exciting part, is having seeded this program and delivering these workshops enabled us to start talking to people on campus that we had not talked much with before. We started to collaborate with the Office of Advanced Research Computing on cross-listing and developing workshops around HPC themes that we had not done before. We were able to contribute teaching assistant help in the form of our graduate specialists to a program called the Erdos Institute, which started out of Ohio State. And that's one of their main offerings is a machine learning bootcamp that's actually going on right now in May. With PhDs from other disciplines learning data science skills that will help them in their careers. And we also were approached by people on campus who saw this model of supervising the graduate specialists. And we implemented two new programs this year, one for a design thinking program that's out of our undergraduate affairs office, and another for an intensive literature review program that is working with our School of Communication and Information. And in those cases, those departments and schools pay for the wages of the students, and we are supervising them according to the graduate specialist model. And so it's actually evolved fairly rapidly to grow into different areas, some unexpected areas, and that's been very exciting. This slide kind of summarizes some of that impact, but I think I'll save time for questions. You can contact me later if you have other questions, but let's go ahead and get into the discussion here.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ryan. And so now we've seen two different approaches at different schools at how they're using students. There are four more videos, but you can watch these. There's actually more, but there's four different schools, I should say, with videos that you can look at to see their approaches. I'm going to introduce the final panelists, and then we're going to have Paula take it over. So Paula Lackey is the academic technologist for data at Carleton College in Minnesota, the United States. Her academic passion has always been research design and resulting data. She is coaching next generation data scientists and researchers to start their careers with good digital habits while also serving the data support needs of her campus through their employment in an undergraduate data squad. Tim Dennis is the director of the UCLA Library Data Science Center. He provides data services, including instruction, consulting, and community building. He is an instructor and instructor trainer with the Carpentries. He recently worked to establish library carpentry as a lesson organization within the Carpentries. Dr. Deborah Wilcher was the data access services manager at the UK Data Service, where among her many duties, she oversaw teams responsible for supporting and training students and researchers who are accessing and using a wide range of social and economic data. And she just moved to Gießen in Germany. And then finally, Dr. Elizabeth Park is a senior research associate, University of Toronto, Canada, where she coordinates the collaborative digital research space and works with humanities and social science researchers to build strengths in those areas. Additionally, she's the lead for faculty consultations on collaborative programming and part of the executive team of the Digital Humanities Network. Paula has sent a number of times, and thanks for all that filled out, a survey. If you have not filled out, I think Paula would still welcome your responses for later. It takes about 5 minutes, so don't do right now. You want to listen to what Paula is going to lead us on. But I am going to turn it over to Paula, who is going to tell us about the results thus far and then open up the floor.
Okay, so the four of us have been talking about this since we got the notice that that we're going virtual for the spring. So we've been talking about this more or less since January, some a little bit earlier. And in this discussion, we've really come to coalesce around how can we use a model that's sharing the support burden, basically. The primary issue that shows up in the survey is that it's too much to try and keep students motivated, trained, pay them. The management aspects of managing students is overwhelming in some cases. So does anybody else want to introduce their aspects of what they're doing briefly? Yeah, go ahead. Well, yeah. I'll start. Sorry. I'll start because a number of years ago, I created a data squad because I could. And I needed students to help me do this data support. And I could, the key business was, it was just me at the tiny institution where I am. And I could do a few projects pretty slowly because it was just me and I had other things I had to do. Or I could do a lot of projects and I could do them pretty slowly, but I could get a lot more done because I had these student workers. And then in the process of doing that, I learned so much about mentoring them and create and instilling in them a sense of, well, basic data skills. And that's what's motivated me, really. It's been a great reward. Now, almost all of the programming and all of the work is done by the students. And I step back and I just sort of keep them going. So go ahead, you guys. Deborah, were you next?
Yeah, I'm happy to go next. So we don't have anything like this, certainly not the UK Data Service. And I'm not sure we have anything remotely like it in the UK. So I started talking to Paula and learned about the data swap model. And I just thought it is absolutely fantastic. And it would solve a lot of the problems that we experience both at the UK Data Service and in the UK as a whole. So we have the, you know, the common problem of students not getting taught data skills. And they grow up to become researchers with poor data skills and a poor understanding of data. And which is fine because that has kept me employed for a few years, helping and guiding these researchers. But Data Squad as a model just would be, I think, just such an incredible addition to the UK academic structure.
I can go. I saw Paula present on the Data Squad at our last in-person conference in Sydney, which was quite lovely. And I really was intrigued by her kind of positioning it as a network, you know, a potential network and model that can be implementable at other institutions. So we're currently doing that at UCLA. We received some funding for like a pilot to hire 4 students for 3 years. And so we're implementing the model, which involves some copying and pasting of some of the fine work that Paula did. So she has written jobs and she's basically created a guidebook and outlined some workflows. So hopefully, I mean, I see this as a real opportunity to provide a network that has an identity that students would want to be a part of and that they can learn and grow through and professionally develop, you know, and become data professionals. So that's what I like, the cross-institutional possibilities of this.
And Elizabeth?
Hi, everybody. So I'm here because of an email that Paula sent on a listserv. I did my undergraduate at Carleton and I saw the name and I just wanted to acknowledge Paula's generosity and willingness to bring me into a panel as a total newbie. And in my position, I come out of digital humanities, and so I'm trying to think about how to create communities of practice, and I've had the opportunity to be involved in a couple, and like Tim was saying, the relationship between a local squad and then a kind of broader network and the kind of professional development and skills, the same thing Deborah was saying about providing inbuilt data skills while working on, say, a master's or a doctoral project strikes me as something to be, I wanted to get on board. And I just also wanted to say, there are a couple of U of T librarians here, and I'm so, so grateful also for the local support. We're 3 campuses across the Greater Toronto area. So we are vast and distributed, and I'm so grateful for all of that support. So thanks, Paula.
So Paula, what is the data show?
So here we go. I'm going to give you a quick rundown of what's going on. And we've got, basically it's the United States that responded. I think in the United States, we're doing a lot more student employment of student workers, but we've got a few Canadians and 3 Europeans answered and 1 in Africa. So yay, thank you. This one is pretty simple. So, put me on the right screen. If you saw that, now this is the little star thingies are the people who do not employ, and the squares are people who do employ. And this is about what kind of service they provide. So the blue ones are just about anyone. So I just made these last night kind of quickly. So sorry about not being a perfect visualization, but the blue spot. So in the UK, they're serving about anyone, including journalists, anybody outside the institution. We've got a few of those in the US. But almost everybody is serving university style, which is to be expected, I guess. There's a few differences, but mostly that's the case. And a few of us are just undergraduates because that's our institution. And then this one is about the same. The stars are those who do not employ students, and the squares are people who do. And then the services are established is dark blue. Orange is in planning. So most of them are dark blue, which I think is encouraging. Pilot, beta, or experimental, these are kind of out of order, but the pilot beta, perhaps, I don't know if you can see this, but this one is a pilot beta program. I think that's in France. Anyway, that's where the GPS location or the latitude-longitude reported. So that gives you a sense about where this information is coming from. This is kind of a craptastic view of the blue bars are the people who do employ and the orange ones are those who do not. And this is, so these are the problems ranked in the survey. There was a rank ordering of which are the worst problems. So in this case, for the people who do employ, their worst problem is having short-term student workers. So I want you to think about these results and what kind of solutions you have for these problems, because a lot of people are reporting, oh, the sample size right now is 50. A lot of people are reporting that this is an issue that students come and go too quickly. And that the second largest problem for the people who do employ student workers is there's too much competition for those good, for the good ones. So they're short-term and they're still fighting for them. And then the third one on the blue bars is insufficient time to manage these people. So my take on this is that it takes so much management to keep them and it's hard to get them. So you're spinning a lot of wheels, not providing service, just trying to get students, trying to get them trained, trying to retain them. And then, you know, then they go off and do something else, which in my case, I'm proud of because I know then that they're going to propagate whatever I've trained them in, but I have a different environment. What I found interesting here is that the people who do not employ students have different results. So, I mean, this one makes sense. The largest obstacle for people who don't employ is that their institution doesn't let them. So yeah, that makes a lot of sense. But still, there's a whole lot on people who don't employ, and the complaint was that there's too much competition. So I find that this is useful. And I think we can come up with shareable solutions to these problems. I'm not gonna go through these in great detail so that we can get to talking about them more. That's another view of the same kind of thing. So this one I drilled in just a little bit further to look at people who do employ student workers and what kind of students they employ. And the results are slightly different in terms of what is the worst problem. For the people who hire a blend of graduate students and undergraduates, so they're probably at the much, much larger institutions, not where I am, campus politics is a big deal. And I was intrigued by that result. Ideally, it's not because I've misinterpreted the data, but I find this an interesting result. So these three levels are a blend as the blue bars, the orange bars are graduate students only, and the red ones are just undergraduates. So we do have slightly different issues in terms of our rank ordering of the problems that we're encountering, depending on what kinds of institutions we're coming from. You can look at those again later. And then I decided, well, what if I look at the people who don't employ student workers and their rank ordering? And I found that this was really interesting, that there are people who are having trouble with the campus politics who do not employ, but they're optimistic. They plan on it, which is kind of cool, actually. This teal color, the top bars, if that's a terrible colorblind color to have in there, but the top bars are the people who plan on employing students in spite of, for instance, the first two problems they have are campus politics and institutional rules. restricting their ability to hire. So they're gonna find a way, which I think is wonderful. And but then the next largest area is we can't use student workers or interns, and it's because they don't have one of their primary rank ordered item is a lack of sufficiently skilled students. So they don't have any, they can't employ them. So that's a pipeline problem. We have to build them so we can have them later, right? Well, maybe. So these are kind of complex graphs to share on a tiny screen, but maybe certainly better than projecting on an auditorium. This is another one that's very similar, talks about the same sorts of things. These are the affiliations that I thought might be of interest, because these we may find allies among these groups. I mean, obviously we've got a lot of IASSISTers, but the survey went out to a number of different groups. I don't know if it actually went through to CoData. I sent it to CoData, RDAP, RDA, CoData. I didn't send to a CoData list, but feel free to send it off to these different organizations if you're members. And SESTA, I'm not. I did try CoData. I'm in SESTA. I'm not obviously not a member of SESTA, but I think that there is much to be done in association with ACRL, since the majority of people who are interested are in the U.S. And if we can create a model where we can share and share alike, it's gonna provide a great deal of resource for the universe. So that's kind of where I am. I'll go back to here to remind you where we all are, and primarily the larger universities. But the next activity I think we should go into, unless one of the others of you have something you'd like to add to any of this. We're good? Okay. So the next activity,
Are you ready for the Jamboard?
Yeah, I think we are.
I put it in chat.
Yeah, go ahead and put it in chat, right. and I'll pull it up here. We have this Jamboard, and maybe I can go full screen. Oh, why can't I see full screen? Never mind. So what we want you to do is to think about what are your solutions? What kinds of things do you have? And I actually have a question. Would it be helpful to see the other list and to organize them as we create them, or to just create them and then organize them? We have it. And is there any opinions on the little screen of faces? No opinions. Well, the survey is wide open. Keep going. I haven't closed it at all. Yeah, I would love to get more Europeans in there. I'm reading the chat, sorry. I should read the out loud, but everybody can see it. Okay, so go ahead, all you do is you grab the little sticky note and write your note. Can't spell. Save it. And then shrink it up, or put it out here. So everybody feel free to what things have worked for you. Yeah, I do that. Oh, I'm sorry. I was reading the green card. I do that as well.
Paula, would it be helpful if we shared some of the comments out loud on the sticky notes, or do you want to give everyone a minute to work?
Well, everybody should be able to see it. Can you still see my screen? I can't tell.
It's kind of small. I mean, we can see it, but it's it's hard to read.
You can feel free to join in the maybe we should repost it. I don't know if more people arrived, some left. The Jamboard is open for anybody. So you can actually, if you open it and just watch, you don't want to say anything, you're shy, okay. Oops, I clicked it. There are now four Jamboards, that's interesting. Yeah, so if you get to the Jamboard and it doesn't look right, go to the first board. Because I think someone's linked to a second board. Yeah, I'm gonna get rid of this so it's out of the way. We already know what we're doing. I'll leave that one. A lot of detail here. Well, it seems we've slowed down a little bit. Should I put some? I'm going to put a little framework underneath it. Oh, good. There's more. Don't let the framework confuse you at all if it's not helpful, but I'm going to change the background for a moment. Now we've got some categories into which we can put our cards. And these are the categories, the first five categories are from the survey, but there's, you know, I missed one. Like I forgot in the survey, I counted time as money, and some people said in comments, money is our biggest problem. So I added time, money in the green column. And some things will be solutions across these columns too. Yeah, this is good. Would anyone in the participants group like to add any comments or questions? Certainly use the chat, but if you raise your hand, Bob Ray can turn your mic on so you can contribute. In the meantime, while you're typing and while we have this dead air, I'm thinking about, so we've been talking about all winter, how can we use a model like data carpentries that, and so Tim has a lot of background in that, which I have almost none. And, but to devise a way to share materials in the data carpentries model, materials, expertise, construct some kind of a stack overflow, but it's focused on supporting individual, like in the academic environment. Style solutions, but all of this is, you know, we're inventing it. So all ideas are highly welcome. And this board will also feed, will take the content out of this board and feed the conversation. In the survey, there's the opportunity to join the organization that is yet to be invented to help coordinate student labor in the service of data. So to some extent, we would like to figure out, we'd like to figure out some way to make this all shareable.
Are any of our participants doing some type of program that cuts across more than one institution currently?
Oh, good question.
And if you'd like to speak, you can use the raise hand function or you can put in the chat, I'd like to speak, and hopefully I'll find you one way or the other.
I just wanted to say that the data squad model and the way you've organized your documentation is something that I will definitely be wanting to learn more about and get more organized with. I'll just say to people watching that your set of videos is really great and your the whole data squad themed. I'm glad I didn't watch those before I recorded mine because I would have been too intimidated to continue at that point.
I spent too much time on the tech, so don't let that slow you down.
The idea of collaboration around the, you know, the just types of training materials, I think is a fantastic idea.
We're also interested in learning from failures. So if anyone's tried to establish something and it just went terribly awry for whatever reason, typically beyond your control, we'd be interested in hearing that too.
I can report that I've had a lot of failure. So, Rob, you pick one person at a time and then they're like, you're really—
All right, we like, have Florio.
Zone tuned in. All right, Florio.
Okay, Florio, you need to, okay, thank you. Florio, speak.
Yep, sorry. Sometimes we have a consultee that's from an external institution, not from Cornell. And so I don't know if you've encountered situations like that, do you help them?
We get that a lot, actually, from our, well, a lot, I don't know, and generally speaking, we get them from our organization that has students working in the community, and then the students come back and they go, we need a database, or, you know, we have this information, we don't know what to do with it. And then we say, well, you need a database, and then they don't know what that is or how to build it, and so we help them with that. So, yeah, but we have the luxury to do that because we can get funding through the community engagement part of our institution.
Is that the reason I ask that is because we have our services are advertised online, and sometimes we get those questions from people who are students actually from other institutions.
Thanks, Florio.
We help them. We help them. That's the answer. My answer to that question, if I were to answer it myself, we actually respond to that because we don't get that often, but we do get that.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a comment in the chat, Lamore Pierre at Yale, and she says, regarding cross-institution collaborations, what about the data curation network? I'm not aware that there are students being used in the data curation network, but I know nothing about it. So if either you would like to speak to that or someone else.
Yeah, I haven't participated in that in a long time, if ever. I don't know, the acronym overlaps with so many others, I've lost track.
Yeah, so Lamore, I made you a speaker if you have something you want to say, and if not, that's okay too. Okay, so Joel said, I don't think we have any students employed in the DCN, so possibly a future opportunity.
Yeah. Well, you know, the NSF is super duper interested right now. I mean, they're very excited about disseminating data training. And the angle on having it be an employment opportunity is a little bit different. But in terms of brain science, when you teach something, you learn it so much more deeply than when you just learn it for yourself. So, as a pedagogical model to get students engaged in the ability to teach something they don't know yet, they have to experience it and then apply it immediately in someone else's project, which is a stunningly great experience for their brain. So I'm excited about the potential of getting NSF funding or some other funding to try and construct a model that we can, a pilot, that we can expand this project.
I don't see the poll function. This is sort of a weird version of, yeah, of this, but how many of you would be interested in potentially joining? You can do the raise hand, Paula's idea for a network. All right, Paula, you got your data squad.
You guys, we're going international, people.
Maybe I should have said anyone like refuse to join Paula's.
Step back.
Somebody found it. Fantastic.
Wow, who did it? That was a big poll.
I couldn't even find the poll. I still don't know where it is, but that doesn't matter.
And the other I would just add, I know that it's not as easy as said, just because of institutional constraints. If we have problems within our institution, trying to do something collaboratively could also have issues.
Yeah. I mean, this is a subset of management philosophy in data science, basically. So there's... one of the ways that I make it sustainable for me, oops, sorry, my computer. I make it sustainable for me is that I use an intern to do the project management. And so I am always on that intern to be like paying attention to the minutia, kind of the HR aspects of it that I don't want to have to deal with so much.
Which... Thanks to everyone. Thanks particularly to our panelists. I think we got to the questions in chat, but if there's any others, we will definitely follow up with. And right now it is a quote social hour lunch, maybe mid-afternoon tea, I suppose. But we look forward to seeing you at 4 o'clock, my time at least, 1 o'clock Pacific for lightning talks and then the closing sessions. And no one on this panel is shy, and feel free to contact us with any questions you might have for the rest of the conference, certainly. And I think it's for 6 months after the HUVA board remains active. And closing remarks, as Stephanie said, thank you.